The Legendarium podcast is brought to you by
you. So please visit patreon.com/legendarium
to support the show. But for now,
welcome to the Legendarium.
But I think from my understanding of the world, boy, are people going to have fun with this episode. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the Legendarium podcast, episode something, 290-something or other. I'm not keeping track these days, but we are coming up on 300. So thank you very much for listening, especially if you've been with us for a while. If you haven't, then maybe you haven't heard me say this 800 times before, or I guess 300. But go to patreon.com/legendarium to support the show if you haven't yet done so, and join the conversation with us either on Reddit, which honestly is a bit of a wasteland these days, or on Discord, which is thriving. It's really kicking over there, so we'd really love to see you there. Anyway, today we are talking about the fifth season by N.K. Jemisin, a long-awaited episode, a very long-awaited episode. Mm-hmm. So I hope everybody enjoys it. I am Craig, your host, and over there, he's like my own personal guardian, always threatening to hold my hand if I don't do what he wants. It's Ryan Bruckman.
And I squeeze very, very hard.
Yeah, okay. And over there, she's hotter than a super volcano and twice as likely to burn down your hometown. It's sometime guest and my wife, Sarah.
Hello. I don't have a cool retort for that because I'm actually so mild-mannered that I would never identify with a super volcano.
No, you wouldn't identify with a super volcano, but that doesn't mean you're not like one. So
okay, let's talk about that later.
Welcome to the Hanks family therapy session here.
Okay, so today, like I said, we're talking about the fifth season. Should I just get into, do we need to do any prep for this, or should I just do the recap and then we start the discussion? What do you think, Ryan?
I think we can just jump into it. I really don't know what we'd prep people for. Our opinions aren't going to be that like earth shattering or anything.
We've got so to talk speak about.
So, oh, yes, no pun intended there, but very well executed if I do say so myself.
Nice, nice. Okay, well, all right, let's do a little recap. So if you haven't read the book, if you haven't listened to the audiobook or whatever, then this may help you out. If you have and it's been a little while, you just want a refresher, here's a few paragraphs on what the book is about. The stillness is anything but. It's a far future Earth in which tectonic forces are far more violent than what we experience today. Those tectonic forces are both exacerbated and calmed by Orogens, or those who practice orogeny, the magic system in this story. The power of the Orogens is so vast and so potentially catastrophic that they have been brought under the thumb of several groups, especially the Fulcrum, an institution that schools and regulates Orogens and their powers, and the Guardians, non-orogenic magic wielders of some kind, who can nullify orogeny and kill errant Orogens. But we learn most of that well into the book. We start by following three characters and knowing nothing about the story around them. There's Essun, who is an Orogen in hiding. She's a mother of two whose story starts in tragedy when her husband kills their son and runs away with their daughter, and she goes on the hunt for them. Cyanite is a mid-level Fulcrum-trained Orogen on a mission to clear some coral from a coastal town's harbor, a mission that turns out to be more fraught than anyone thought. And finally, Demaya, who is ostracized by her family and friends for her orogenic abilities and scooped up by a guardian and taken as a new recruit to the Fulcrum. Their stories appear wholly separate at first, except thematically, but then they weave together in unexpected ways that I'm hesitant to spoil for anyone who hasn't read the book, but which we are going to do very soon. So if you like a good surprise and you haven't read the book yet, please go give it a shot and then come back, listen to the episode. Because, yeah, we are going to spoil the crap out of this entire book. This is not one of those part one, part two things. We're just going to talk about the whole book, including the ending. So now is your last chance, I think. I don't know when we're going to get to the ending, but you have been warned.
From here on out, it's on you if you hear a spoiler.
Exactly. Okay. Now, Ryan.
Yes.
How did you feel going into reading this book? And, you know, were you as nervous about reading it for the podcast as I was?
Not nervous, no. this is one of those book series that I will be 100% honest. I had no idea what it was, what I was getting to. I was not aware of N.K. Jemisin a whole lot before this. So honestly, there wasn't really anything by way of high or low expectations on this. I just didn't know what I was getting into at the beginning. And honestly, I will say that did affect my initial enjoyment of reading this series, because this is not standard fare, at least not in the way that it is presented. And if you're not forewarned about that, if that's not something that you are aware of going into it, it might put a bad taste in your mouth at the very beginning. I think it is one that you can wash away fairly easily, honestly. But I mean, let's just call the elephant in the room. The second person narrative was hard. It was hard to deal with at the beginning.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah, I was pretty nervous about doing this episode, just because it's not because I'm scared to have an opinion that's different than other people's. Obviously, that's not an issue that I deal with. But I will say I'm pretty proud of this little podcast that we've created. That's it's a little haven that kind of sits outside of the contemporary political stuff of the day, and it's nice for us to get away from that stuff. And I hope it's nice for other people to have a place to get away from this stuff. But I was a little bit afraid, because I know that Jemisin and these books, her works, they're a hotspot that a lot of discussion about contemporary politics revolves around. And I was a little bit nervous to get into that, because it's a bit like that, the ill-fated Larry Correa episode that I ended up pulling. Mm-hmm. There were probably reasons that I could have left it, but ultimately it was just like, you know what, it feels weird for us to wade into anything like that, right? And so that's what made me nervous to get into it. But I will say, after having read the book, boy, was I relieved. Mm-hmm. Because, and I'm going to get into why, but I don't feel like it has to revolve around those political issues. Like, you don't have to press every hot button in a discussion of this book. Not to say it can't be done or it doesn't encourage that sort of thing, but does that make sense?
Yeah, I think I agree with it about 75-80% of what you're saying, because
story of our lives.
Yeah, because I think that also there, you don't have to go through and address those things. There's enough in the story if you don't want to. But I think it's a mild disservice to the author, who made very clear some intent that she wanted these things to be clear themes of her story.
Yeah, you can't ignore them.
Don't ignore them.
Right.
Yeah, we need to make sure, you know, have discussion, be aware of them, but I don't think it has to be the only thing that you pull out of this book is political commentary.
Right. Well, but yeah, I mean, that maybe that's a good time for a trigger warning. We will acknowledge the existence of political issues during this episode, yes, probably. So if that triggers you, head out now. Okay, so Sarah, mm-hmm, what about you? So this is a question that we got from Jafu. I'm sticking with that pronunciation, by the way, on Discord. He said, I want to hear about your expectations for the book and what they were and how the experience compared. And I want to throw that to you specifically because you are not steeped in the fantasy community the way that we are. And so what were your expectations? Were they anything beyond what I had told you?
No, they were not anything beyond what you had told me.
What did I tell you?
You told me, like, there's this trio of books, or trilogy, I guess you would say, in the fantasy.
the lingo.
I'm pretty well versed, I must say. Trilogy of books that were very well regarded. They won something called the Hugo.
This is my favorite. I love this.
Which I took to be a big deal. And that they were political, and they did talk about race. And then other than that, I think my expectations were what my expectations always are when I agree to read a fantasy novel that you ask me to read, which is like, okay, well,
take a deep breath. Let's see.
This isn't going to be my cup of tea exactly, but I'm willing to try, and we'll see how it goes.
How did it go? How was the tea?
The tea ended up being piping hot and great. I actually enjoyed it quite a lot. I think part of it was because her style, and I hesitate to even say these things because I have so little experience reading fantasy and sci-fi, but I feel like her writing style was more accessible than other fantasy novels that I've read.
That's so interesting to hear. Oh my word. It just goes to show the different types of books that you read.
For sure.
Versus what I and many other fantasy readers go for.
Yeah.
Because this is, like Ryan said, this is not your typical fare,
right,
for an epic or high fantasy.
I think that's probably why I gravitated towards it more, is because I didn't have to understand the way that fantasy usually works in order to be like, oh, I can do this.
Okay. Yeah, wait, Ryan, what epic fantasy?
It's flirting on the edge of it. I mean, on the scale of the
certainly cataclysms and all that.
Yeah, it fits. The feel of the whole piece, though, with epic fantasy, you get so used to, you know, this huge world building and all these different things. And this world is big, but it's in that sense of small tribes of people. It doesn't really doesn't have the grandiose feeling to me that a lot of epic fantasy has, where, yeah, you get to learn the names of 20 different nations and their special cultures and everything.
Right.
This is more, you've got like three or four core groups. So it lacks that feel, but it still has enough elements that if someone said it was epic fantasy, I wouldn't argue with them.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. So let's talk a little bit about style. I know we got some style questions in here. I'm going to skip a couple to get to... Oh, where is it? What Lady Sweden asks, what did you think of the writing style apart from the second person? I want to come back to the second person in just a moment and how we felt about it. So, Sarah, you enjoyed the style, and that's probably what kept you going, especially at the beginning. Ryan, you had a hard time with the second person, at least at the start. I get that. We're not going to talk about the second person yet. I will say the style generally, without talking about the second person portions specifically, it was a bit like she was trying to... I don't want to say walk a tightrope. It was like she was jumping between two tightropes, and one of them was the typical kind of straightforward prose style that we know. Granted, it was in third person present instead of third person past, which we're used to probably most often in these. But then she would go into this kind of, I call it Cormac McCarthy territory. If you've ever read Cormac McCarthy, he's the kind of writer who would look at you askance if you ever mentioned commas. You know, what's a comma? Mm-hmm. You know, just very clipped short sentences, weird punctuation, and, you know, paragraph breaks and unexpected locations and that kind of thing. And it was, for me, a little bit jarring. That was the part that was jarring, was to try to get on her page, so to speak, when she would switch between the two modes. And I'm like, oh, okay, we're in McCarthy mode. Oh, no, okay, now we're in Rothfuss mode or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, does that make sense?
Yeah, I could see that. And actually, I recognize having felt that way while going through the books as well. I think, though, to me, I noticed that those variations, it didn't seem like... It seemed intentional to me, in the sense that, especially with the way this world exists and everything being jarring and... I mean, I have to describe it this way, and it may make zero sense, so I apologize.
I'm excited already.
But this whole world is broken plates and, you know, earthquakes and shifting and hard edges. This whole world is just all of that ripped edges feel. And so to have things be shorter and rougher, and that in terms of this writing style, to me, speaks to match the world and the characters that we're seeing.
Yeah.
And so that's the way I took it. Is it jarring? Yes, because it has edges and it's supposed to be.
Okay.
Yeah. But that for me was the only thing that really stood out about that.
I like that. That's a good like meta explanation. Yeah, I don't know. Sarah, do you have any response?
I just appreciated that the way it was written, as I said before, it seemed accessible to me. There wasn't whenever I've read other fantasy novels, it seems like a lot of times things get real flowery, real lofty, real descriptive.
Yeah.
And that is not my jam. And so to have it be more straightforward and at times jarring, it didn't bother me at all. It felt like I was just reading from a more contemporary writer.
Sure.
And that's what I tend to like anyways. And so
a little more down to broken earth.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, you could say that.
You're really proud of yourself for that.
Come on, I just came up with that. I didn't even workshop that. That was you know, sometimes genius just happens. Okay, now let's talk about the second person. Because this is one of the expectations I had going in. Everybody talked about, oh my gosh, she writes in the second person. It's so weird, or it's so brilliant, or whatever. And this is one of the areas where I didn't take any time to adjust. I loved it outright. I really enjoyed it. And I did not expect that. If you told me, and you know, people did, they tell me beforehand, oh, it's in the second person, I'll be like, oh, that's tedious. It sounds like, when you say that, it sounds like, oh, okay, so it's some writing exercise from you know, PhD level program. Like, oh, okay, write an entire novel in the second person, which she doesn't do. A third of it is in the second person. But anyway, and so I'm like, oh, I don't want to read somebody's writing exercise. But I thought it turned out to be really effective, and I quite enjoyed those portions. And here's my theory. I think I've run this by you before, but I'm not sure, Ryan, if I've mentioned this. So here's my theory. My theory is, here's a woman who wants to write a book that is largely speaking to issues of race and oppression and systems of power and all that stuff, right? So now she's got this character, Essen, and she wants people to see, she wants people to really get where Essen is coming from, feel her pain, understand her situation. And for whatever reason, you know, some people might not, in a typical stylistic setting, might not identify with certain characters. Let's take Stormlight Archive, for example. It's got a million different characters. Take your primary three, you got, you know, Kaladin and Shallan and Dalinar, and people have their favorites. And they're like, oh, you know, I just don't really identify with Shallan. Mm-hmm. Right? I just don't identify with Dalinar's story. I'm all about Kaladin, right?
Right.
And by using the second person, I think she was saying, screw you guys, I'm not giving you a choice. You don't have a choice. You will identify with this woman.
Mm-hmm.
And she does that by putting you behind her eyes, so to speak, so that you see what she sees. And by using the second person, by saying, you experience this, you see this, you feel this, whatever, I think it was a really effective way for her to convey that character.
I agree. And that's, I think, one of the reasons why initially I had a very difficult time with it is because I am not a woman. I have not lived through a lot. I have not lived through oppression.
Your skin is nearly clear.
Yeah. This is not my lens that I look through.
Sure.
And so when you hear you, especially cross-gender, cross those things, it was difficult for me at the beginning to go, wait, no, hold on. This isn't how I identify. This isn't how I deal with these things. So then you have a choice. Do you get to the point, there's kind of this moment of friction when that happens, if you're feeling that way, where you say, okay, I can either say that I don't identify this way, I don't deal with this, and break off and say I'm not dealing with this, or let go and actually try and experience it through that lens.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, well, that's what I'm going to get, what I'm going to do. And as soon as I do that, you know, it's a fantasy novel. You can decide to not give it a ton of weight if you don't want to, in that sense. So for those who are like, well, I can't do that, like, you can, like, it's very possible to do. But once I kind of let myself go and say it doesn't matter that this isn't the way I normally see things, try and see it through this lens. I was able to enjoy the second person narrative a lot more. It wasn't jarring anymore.
Mm-hmm.
For me to make that switch. Did I understand everything? No, I did not.
Yeah.
But that's okay. That's for me, especially if in subsequent rereads and things like that, going back through it, you know, I feel like there will be less time getting into that
sure
mindset than what initially was required.
No, I think that's really interesting you say that. It's a bit like when people say, oh, I kind of want to read the Silmarillion, but I know I'm going to be missing so much context. And I'm like, don't worry about it. It's okay. You can be missing context and it's still enjoyable for other reasons, you know, mm-hmm. And then as you gain more context, other things will unfold, and, you know, that's okay. That's what rereads are for, and future learning. And I think this book would benefit greatly from rereads. In fact, I think I'll get to that in a moment. But Sarah, I'm going to kick the second person question to you and give you again Jafu's wording of it here, mm-hmm. who said, did you like the second person narrative? And if not, why are you wrong?
Jafu, I did like it. So no worries there. I'm very curious to see how this unfolds in the next two books in the trilogy. Because, well, there were two things that stood out to me.
I believe we just got a commitment. Sarah's coming back for two more episodes.
I didn't say anything about episodes.
Oh, okay.
No, there were two excerpts in particular that felt like they were giving hints about the use of the second person. And I don't know if that's true, but these are both really short. There's one line that says, "After all, a person is herself and others. Relationships chisel the final shape of one's being. I am me and you." And then there's another one. Mm. This is from the prologue, talking about Essen. Because at this point, Essen in the prologue is not spoken about in the second person.
Right.
She says, "The woman I mentioned, the one whose son is dead, she was not in Eumenes, thankfully, or this would be a very short tale, and you would not exist."
Oh, it's interesting.
Just fascinating. And I don't know whether that, in a way, it makes me feel like you would not exist, like you're her descendant, or you would not exist because you're the reader and you're observing this, or you would not exist because in a second you're going to step into Essen's shoes. Like, I don't know. I just think it's really rich. And in order, you're right, like the second person is such a writing exercise that can be a little like hoity-toity, but to do it well, I think there has to be some depth to it. And I feel like there is, but I don't know. I don't know the full shape of it yet.
Yeah, no, I really like that passage. And we know by the ending that it's Hoa who is telling the story of Essen. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder now, I hadn't thought of it before, but I wonder if he is telling one of her children or grandchildren or descendants,
right.
if he is telling the story to them.
Mm-hmm.
But when it goes into the second person, it sounds more like he's talking to Essen. You know, I don't know. It's,
that's true.
It's complicated.
Yep.
Ryan, you're laughing. You got a smile on your face.
Well,
tell me why.
I have finished.
Justify your smile, Ryan.
I have finished the series, and that does a whole lot. That statement does a whole lot for me. That tells me how far in advance she planned things out.
Oh, for sure.
Oh yeah. These days, I don't imagine there are a lot of writers who write a book and then figure out the series later.
Yeah.
Right.
Because it.
You sell the trilogy.
Yeah, that's really, I like that a lot. Nice. That opened up a new perspective to me.
Okay.
Reviewing that.
I feel like you get the sense at the end of the book that everything she's done in the fifth season is just getting her to the story that she really wants to tell. Like, the fifth season is just like, just setting the scene, and everything that comes later is the real deal.
I guess we'll see.
Yeah, exactly.
To be perfectly honest, if there weren't two other books, if things just ended here and this was it, I'd be like, damn, that was a good book. And I am satisfied. And
with the exception of the cliffhanger last line.
we'll get there. anyway, I had something else I was going to say, and that kind of chased it out of my brain. Thanks, Ryan.
You're welcome.
Yeah. That's
I helped too.
So let's talk about another point from Jafu. We're getting all Jafu stuff out of the way, right? just
as one should.
Exactly. Get it over with. He says, "I feel like there was a lot of info that's fed to you without context." This is, I think, more stylistic kind of stuff. "A lot of info that's fed to you without context, which makes piecing the world together a challenge. This isn't uncommon for epic fantasy, but I felt like it was on the extreme end, and I didn't expect that of a Hugo winner for some reason. Feels like there's a conversation to have about the use of this in fantasy literature in general, and specifically about whether it worked for you in fifth season." So this is something I struggled with a lot my first time through. So let me explain that. I have not read this book twice, but I have read it 1.5 times. A few months ago, when I had surgery on my nose and throat, and so I was laid up for a while, and I started the book, and I made it about halfway through. And now I know if I had literally gone like 5 more pages, I would have been hooked. Mm-hmm. And I it's not like I put the book away in disgust and was like, oh, this is so boring. It was just, you know, you get distracted. And if a book hasn't hooked you, then those distractions are allowed to take over. So I read about half of it, put it aside. And then when it came time to read it for the show, I was like, you know what? I'd better start again at the beginning and try again, you know, from the beginning, so I don't miss out on, or, you know, not remember some of the context or something. And it was so much better the second time through. And this kind of gets to a question that someone else was asking about going back and, oh yeah, Lammy Lambs said, "Since you finished the book, have you gone back and reread the beginning with context?" Yes. And yes, I've actually read the prologue in the first chapter now 3 times. So anyway, what was I saying? Oh yeah. So this idea of not giving you all the details it is very common, but usually you have the chapter 2 dump. Frodo and Gandalf sit down around the fire and they're like, this is the One Ring. Or, you know, Vin and Kelsier sit down and he's like, you are the chosen one. Or, whatever conversation. There's the
all played by a poor man's Christopher Lee.
Correct. Al-Anon sits down with Shay Ohmsford and is like, the Sword of Shannara. So that is totally normal, and you kind of expect that. You get nothing like that in this book. It's doled out piecemeal. Every once in a while, you get another piece of context. And meanwhile, you've been getting all these references to the way that the Fulcrum works and the way the Guardians work, and you're just like, I always... throw up my hands. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Sarah, did that bother you?
It really didn't. And I think that's because I went into reading a fantasy novel being like, well, I'm not going to get most of this because that's how these books always are. And it just, I just decided to be okay with it. And I think I didn't mind as much because I liked the, that sounds so simplistic, but it's true. Like I did like the characters more and I was more interested in the conversations they were having and in the inner monologues they were having, that I didn't really care so much that I didn't understand the whole idea of like stone lore or guardians and who they are. Like I didn't need, even though I was aware that stuff didn't really make sense to me yet, I didn't mind so much, I think, for those two reasons.
Do you feel like you retained that information as you went through and so the revelations weren't so revelatory? If that makes sense,
yeah.
or did it just kind of like fly over your head and you're like, I don't care, whatever.
No, I think I got enough in order to understand later when things did fall into place, like, oh, right, that makes sense because of that thing from before.
Yeah.
But I'm sure that I have gone back to read the prologue again and there were a lot of things that I was like, oh, right. Yeah. I completely ignored that. I didn't pay attention to it. Right.
Yeah.
It didn't pique my interest at all initially. So I'm sure there's plenty of things like that, but I understood enough that I feel like I think I get it. I think I get what's going on here.
Ryan, what about you?
Yeah, this one, I feel like a lot of authors, especially in epic fantasy, you've talked about the chapter 2 dump, but they'll toss these things out and they'll tie a little rope to it and hand that back to you and say, just hold on to it for a little bit. So you kind of build this little web of things and then all of a sudden this magic moment
lies. Sorry.
The author, you know, is like, all right, now pull on the string and watch what happens, and snap together, there's this beautiful, like, oh, there it's yeah. So cool and everything. This one, it took longer than I had wanted to give I wanted to give it for that moment of snap it all together. Mm-hmm. and see what it is. Honestly, it's a danger if you are trying to attract newer readers to fantasy or whatever. Mm-hmm. But that's, I don't really think that's her goal here. Like, it's not, you know, I need to get new people into fantasy
at all.
But that being said, it's the reveal is rewarding. Like, it's still, it's like, oh yes, that's a lot of pieces that you kept floating out there. But, you know, it still felt nice because when you see the whole picture put together, when the big revelation, I think we haven't even...
We're getting there. I've got a question about that from Discord. Yeah.
But when you get the big revelation, you're like, oh, yeah, okay. Every piece that you can remember, you start to go, it goes here. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's a very rewarding feeling, but I know there's still ones floating out there. Even having finished the series, there's still pieces that are floating out there that I did not grab a hold of and pull in, because there was just so many.
So you've read all three. Have you gone back and read any portion since you finished it?
No.
Okay, so it's just one read through.
One read through.
Yeah.
That's far. I haven't been gone back in yet.
Well, having read the first part of this several times, I would definitely recommend. You know, it's a bit like the Wheel of Time, where the prologue suddenly means so much more. And I've only read one book, you know, maybe it'll mean even more two more books from now. But yeah, I would definitely say go back and check out the prologue.
I appreciate it. Without spoiling anything, she does a very good job of, like a lot of really good authors can do, you'll realize, oh yeah, at the end of book one here, back in the prologue, you get point A to B, and you're like, oh yeah, that makes sense. But then you finish it and you realize A to B was actually A to D, but it still works.
Right.
If I know that.
I think I got you.
It will make more sense after book three.
That was a weird point, but I think I get you. Okay, so let's talk then about... Oh, let's see. Which way do I want to go with this? You know what? Let's address Kiptan's question first, and then I'm going to get to Colonel Rabbit talking
Colonel Rabbit.
Is that a thing? Is that a reference to something?
No, I have no idea. It's a funny name.
Great names. I love it. Okay, so Kiptan says, who do you have the most pity for in this book? Essen, Uche, Alabaster, Corundum, Lerna, Terimo, Eumenes, etc. I will tell you right off the bat, it ain't Lerna.
Who is that guy?
Okay, can I just say, this is one of those times when I liked so much of what she did in this book, and then there were a couple of spots where I was just like, no, nope, no, no, no. And one of those was when she shows up in this geode city, right? Which is awesome, by the way, an excellent setting. This giant geode in the, you know, under the crust of the earth or whatever. And she goes in this geode city and they're showing her around. And then somebody shows up and she's like, is that you, Lerna? And it's this moment of revelation and, oh my gosh, this character, this blast from the past. And I'm like, who?
Yeah, he didn't make enough of an impression on me initially.
I haven't gotten back to the first part where apparently Lerna appears, but anyway, so it's this character whose appearance and revelation doesn't land for me in the slightest. And then she goes on for fully like two or three pages where Lerna is telling you the story of how he came to the Geode City. And by the end of it, I'm like, I do not care. I don't care.
I cared because I kept being like, okay, she's going to tell me something that tells me who he is. And then she did. And I was like, oh, okay. Good to see you again, Lerna. Welcome. Welcome to the geode. I'm new here, but I'm glad you came.
So, yeah, that I hated that moment. I was like, I would take a blue pencil to that so hard. Either got to give us more of Lerna beforehand so that he makes more of an impression, or scrap this. Well, sorry, go on.
I figured with Lerna's appearance specifically, he is not the one that I have the most pity for.
No.
He'd be on the list. But
well, all these people are on the list, Ryan.
On Kipton's list. But when he first appeared, it was, and she'd made a big deal at the beginning. Again, this is one of those floating pieces that sits out there until it all snaps together. At the beginning, he's the one who shows her like as much as love exists for her in the early portions of her story, he's the one who shows it to her beginning on there. So I see him come back and I go, we're getting a love story now. Lerna's coming back. The whole thing with Alabaster is kind of weird and on its own thing. And the island, anyway, Lerna's back. So this is going to be our love story. And I was like, okay. And
fizzle. And nothing.
And then Lerna, at least for book one, it was like, okay, thank you for visiting. It was good to see you again.
No, it wasn't. It was not. I assure you, it was not. No, thank you for visiting. Okay, but who do we feel the most pity for in this book?
Acute pity for me was Demaya during the scene when her guardian breaks her hand.
Oh, yeah.
That was the most, like, I don't know, tied for the most heart-wrenching moment.
Do you feel like that's because you're a mom?
No. I felt like I was relating to it as Demaya, not as like the mother of a child who would be hurt that way. I think because, and the way she wrote it was also so captivating and like heartbreaking, because when she finally asks her guardian, whose name I cannot remember, when she asks her guardian, why are you doing this? And he says, I love you. And you realize like what an abusive cycle and like spiral this all is. Like, I'm hurting you to keep you safe. I have to control your every word, and you're not allowed to say no to me because of how much I love you.
Right.
It's what is so this? Toxic.
Weren't we watching a movie recently with that kind of psychologically abusive parent-child relationship? Tangled.
Yes. Oh my gosh. We were driving and the kids were watching Tangled in the back seat, and me and Craig, and we could hear it. Me and Craig kept looking at each other being like, it's so awful. Like, oh yeah. Anyways. Yes. Good.
Yeah.
Good.
He's one of the worst villains, Disney villains.
I'm sorry. Okay. Quick legendary tangent here. I think that Tangled and A Goofy Movie are both wildly underappreciated for how emotionally complex they are.
Mm.
And both nearly perfect movies. So,
do you have a Legendarium tangent sound effect?
Oh, we should. You make us one right now?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, you're in charge of that.
Okay.
Get on with it.
Yes, get on with it.
So let's get back to the question at hand. Who do we feel the most pity for? For me, I don't know exactly. I think Demaya might be a strong contender, but I'd have to go with Essen on this one. And it might be that second person narrative that I was talking about, where I was forced to feel what she was going through in a way mm-hmm. that isn't typical with your third person narrative. So
I'm going to throw Alabaster.
I almost said that, but I'm curious to hear why for you.
He's a tragic, tragic soul.
A lot of people would not think of Alabaster as someone to pity because he is so powerful, because he is, you know, he has everything. He actually can get away with with all these things. But that placement is also incredibly lonely, and it becomes very apparent as he works with Cyanite. Yeah, this four ringer who's been sent to breed with him, and and literally that's their purpose, is to breed. And so he realizes, you know, I just feel like living a life with that much power, with as much knowledge as he has, being that lonely is just so tragic and so sad.
Mm-hmm. And on top of all that stuff, all this power that he possesses and the ostracization that comes along with that, turns out he's gay as well.
Mm-hmm.
And being forced to go through this breeding program can't be an easy thing.
Repeatedly, endlessly.
And,
you know, for all of his power, he's still enslaved. Like, he still is ostracized by an entire world, considered the thing to fear, and therefore is hated. The more power he attains, in a way, the more hated he is. Like, it's... Yeah, I think you've made a strong case for Alabaster.
Oh, boy. All right. So,
quick question here.
Oh, okay.
It is not.
I'll move on to the next one in a second.
Is Alabaster gay or is he bisexual?
I don't know exactly. It's not totally clear in this book.
Okay.
To me, he read as gay.
I read him as gay.
Yeah.
Yes, I think, well, maybe we discuss this a little bit more.
Love is very
fluid. So to speak.
That is a big point of these books, though. We can talk about it without treading into terrible things.
No, that's fine. This is okay.
The sexuality of the people in this world, the political viewings, the race, and the different groupings. I mean, like, they're all. It is all very big parts of the story, mm-hmm. and the fluidity of the sexuality of these people. Yeah. I don't know that Jemison is coming out and saying, this is the way that life should be, because this is also a terrible place to live.
Yeah,
this is not a fantasy world I'd want to live in. But to give us characters who have these different perspectives and orientations and identities, like, and how they would live in these worlds, like, that is good representation. I feel like that it was nice to see those things, even though it was surprising to me at the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you remember when we read The Blood Mirror, Book 4 of the Lightbringer series, and there's a whole storyline with which I really, really identified.
Mm-hmm.
People can go back and listen to that episode, and that's fine. But that really gave me, I think, more of an appreciation for the idea of representation. And I think it's a valuable thing. I think that a lot of the conclusions that she seems to come to in this book, as far as the way the world works and the way human nature is and all that, like, I have serious, big, major disagreements with her. And, you know, would love one day to hash those out. That would be a lot of fun, or at least interesting, if not fun. So I have these huge disagreements, but at the same time, I do find it valuable to be forced to see in the second person narrative through the eyes of a middle-aged to elderly black woman. That's not something that, you know, that I get a ton of in my fantasy reading, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or the eyes of the little girl, or through Alabaster, or whatever, these different experiences, I do find it valuable.
Yeah.
Even if, so we talked a little bit earlier about how, you know, as you read through it and you don't have all the context clues for what's going on in the story, it can get a little bit wearying. And like, similarly, I know that there's stuff I'm missing because I didn't, because I'm not a middle-aged black woman. Like, there are things that I don't understand about what she's communicating through Essen, and that's fine. That's okay. I'll get what I can get, you know, for now. So, let's go to, what was I going to say? Aridandus asked, what do you think about what Jemison was trying to say about the use of power, political, cultural, magical, otherwise, in this book? Now, this is that's a big question, because that's basically, so what do you think about this book? Right? What do you think about the point of this book? You know, like I said, I have some pretty big disagreements with the conclusion she comes to, but I'm interested to kick it to you guys and hear what you have to say. Sarah?
Well, I feel like I've been teased into what you're going to say about what your big disagreements
are. In a moment, I want to hear you guys. I talked for a moment already.
Yeah, I mean, I felt like the uses of power, how would I say it? Ryan, I think, was mentioning, you know, that race and sexuality and all these things are such major themes of the book and of this world. But at the same time, it's not race in the way we think of it. It's not a matter of the color of your skin. It's a matter of your abilities, right?
Right, which introduces all sorts of troubling stuff.
Sure. But point being, I think the thing that stands out the most to me is how all the ideas that this society tends to hold towards origins about them being dangerous and needing to be controlled and everything, it comes from a desire to control what they're afraid of, you know. And I don't know how many people listening to this will have read the book Stamped from the Beginning by Ibram Kendi.
But there's so many. It's a huge overlap in the readership.
I'm sure
there.
Venn diagram is practically a circle. But his point in that book is that, you know, we have this idea that racial discrimination comes from racist ideas. But if you look at the development through the literature and the history, it seems to be more flipped, that the racist ideas come from the racial discrimination. We come up with these racist ideas in order to justify our racial discrimination. And I think that's true of a lot of things. We come up with justifications for the way we feel after the fact, right? And that's what I just kept thinking throughout this book, is that the people in power have, and the institutions in power have perpetuated ideas about the origins that are not accurate, that are discriminatory and biased and oppressive, in order to make everybody believe that the origins are not human and that the way that they're treated is okay. And so I think that just kept coming to me over and over again. Like, all the bad things that people say about origins in this book, it's just like, oh, that came after the fact. You were scared and you came up with reasons that it was okay for you to hate them.
Yeah. I mean, that's, you know, it's tale as old as time, I think. Ryan, thoughts?
Yeah. There's a few things that she does in here that really stand out to me and that draw very clear parallels to now. And I actually took time. I don't always research our books or do a ton of things afterwards.
Nor should we. I think this should be about our experience. Reactions to it. Yeah.
But after finishing, I wanted to go back and try and learn a little bit more about the author's intention and go and read some of what she has said about her own works.
Yeah.
Things like that. And trying to read and understand, did I get what you were aiming for, or did I have a different experience because I don't have the same lenses that you want me to see through this or whatever.
Unavoidably, probably.
And some of them... Some come straight across. One of the big examples in this book, I think, that draws a direct parallel to modern day and current stuff is with origins and the way that they are named, the ragas.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's no accident that's a two syllable word with a double G in the middle.
Yeah, it's that right there. It, to me, I went through those moments, and the fact that Alabaster, you know, used it as both a it's a word that he owns, but it's also a derogatory against.
Right, trying to reclaim something or...
things. To sit there and look at it and try and go through this viewpoint and go, I can see, this is a very clear correlation. This shouldn't take a whole lot for you to see the comparison here. but maybe this will help me understand better the real world correlation here. That moment in the book was very clear. This book for me also, I feel like it set up a lot of, this is the way things are now in the power structure. It teaches you about, you know, the fulcrum and having the guardians and what they do, and the way where origins are, but it doesn't explain a lot of the why. I don't feel like there's a lot of the why things are the way that they are, because as soon as you start getting into the why, we get into the discussion of what Sarah was just talking about. It's where did these ideas come from or whatever.
Right.
And at the end of reading the first time, my feelings were, I want to understand better why this world is the way it is. You know, what happened when everything fell apart that has put these people in this? And is it just fear that's making these people want to keep these origins in check, essentially, with the guardians? And why are guardians allowed the latitude,
the power structure that they have? Yeah.
You know, why is the structure? Why sure, is the man?
Sure, and no. I think that especially gets highlighted when Alabaster and Cyanite go to this little utopian island where they're able to have their polyamorous love triad for one thing, but also like there's no distaste for origins. And actually it's like, yeah, they keep us safe. Like they're an important part of our social structure. Like we respect that gift, you know, when you have that comparison available, I think it's really illuminating.
Hey, I found the island. I want to come back to the point we were just talking about, the stuff we were just talking about, but the island real quick, or maybe this does kind of lean into our subject at hand, because when I first got to the island, I had the same thought, like, oh my gosh, she's giving us a utopia to
this
compare
is the way
against.
Life should be.
But then I thought about it for a second. I'm like, well, no. No, because these people are pirates. They're literally pirates who go and raid coastal villages and take whatever they can from others to support their lifestyle back on the island. This is no, this is no paradise of angelic people who are, you know, living their best lives or whatever. Maybe she was going for utopia pass on that one.
Well, the other day I heard this quote. It has been on my mind so much. I heard it in a podcast from a writer named Adrienne Marie Brown. And she's talked about how utopias are always built on top of dystopias.
Oh, boy. Now we're getting into some stuff. Here we go.
The point is, in this world, a little island utopia that exists in a larger a planet full of dystopias, it's going to have to function differently than it would if the whole world was like with origins and we're fine. Like we're happy to live peacefully and whatever. Like they have to function differently. And you saying like this isn't a paradise of angelic people. Like I don't think a utopia has to be all angelic people.
That's
right?
What it means.
Like, I mean, they are living, at least as far as what we're given in the story, I feel like we're given a lot of evidence that the life they live there is very peaceful and happy and fun and fulfilling. And except for when Cyanide gets into the mix, we don't even necessarily learn that they're hurting anybody. They're stealing goods, but like you got to do what you got to do in a world that's mostly dystopia. Like, I don't know. It just, to me, it was unambiguously like, I like you guys. Yeah. I'm on team island people.
It seemed the island portion, meeting, what was his name? I swear it starts with an I.
Yeah, no, you're
Inan.
Right.
Inan. Yeah, Inan. You know, the Jack Sparrow of...
yeah.
Sure, sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Going through that whole sequence, I read it and I kept going, this is the break for our characters. This is a chance for them to breathe and to develop in a different way other than just through the friction of hardship and struggle out here. And I looked at the time on the island, and you know that the other shoe's going to drop at some point in time.
Yeah.
And realizing a little bit to Sarah's point of like, it's a different lifestyle, everything. They have to do things differently. The part of the reason that they're able to survive is that honestly, being on an island is the worst place you can be in a world that is shocked with earthquakes all the time.
Which I really liked. Those times when she obviously thought through the consequences of her magic system, that's always nice to read.
Yeah.
Sorry, go on.
But so to me, I looked at it like, okay, that they've traded off the natural safety. So they've traded off all these other things to have this other utopia where they don't have to protect themselves quite so much. I enjoyed the island. I liked the island, but I did not think that the island would last. I kept looking at it going, this is not going to stay this way forever. Yeah. This is a temporary piece. And honestly, I cannot think of really any utopian examples in fantasy, in any works anywhere, where the utopia lasts outside of the introduction of one foreign element.
Mm. Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, utopia, I think I've talked about this on a previous episode, but the word...
like no place, right?
The word utopia in Greek, like from the original Greek, starting with a U, that means no place. It does not exist. It cannot exist. Mm-hmm. It runs into human nature and implodes, right? So a utopia with an E at the beginning, utopia, like that would be... the Greek for a good place. And anyway, so it's interesting that we have used this word utopia to mean paradise. What it does. Yeah. Anyway, so it's very interesting. Speaking of which, all right. So as far as stuff that I wasn't quite on board with, I have forgotten why I wanted to get into this, Ryan. It was something you said that reminded me of, you know, I wanted to say something about how I was a little bit worried. My expectation going in was that this was going to be some like a racial allegory. And I feel like it didn't quite fall into that trap. There was the allegorical elements were few and far between. When she got into them, I thought it was that was the book at its weakest, because allegory tends to fall apart really quickly upon any sort of examination. And those were the parts where I struggled a little bit, where there was a part, let me see if I can get back to where I was looking. Like there's a part, most of the way through the book, and she does this frequently throughout, where this is a theme she returns to a lot, and that's missing history, or the things you weren't told, the things you weren't taught. And those are the parts where I was like, you know, she's talking about the Demaya is talking to Binoff, and Binoff is like, you know, the stuff the tutors teach you about humanists was about how humanists was founded and gaps in the history. And it's like, oh boy, all right, well, here we go. And those are the moments when it's like, okay, she's making a very, very clear statement about our world. And that's when it gets a little bit tedious, and I find things to nitpick and disagree with. And so as the more she stayed kind of big picture and like human nature and various experiences, those are the parts I was like, oh man, I feel like I'm learning something, I'm seeing something new. And then the parts when she tried to like take direct aim at some really specific contemporary issue, I was like, all right, sorry, I'm off the train for a moment. And then she would shift out of it and I was okay. So there was some other stuff that I could pull up, but Ryan, you look thoughtful.
No, I can understand having that feeling.
I did find another one.
I feel that I actually applaud her. Normally, I don't know. I will tell you right now, and this hypocrisy abounds, I'm sure, from me on this, but
yeah,
I will applaud her for being willing to be a little more specific about this and have that and make a very clear statement on that in the ways that she does it, because I don't feel like it's the main point of the book. Like she doesn't say, like, you know, doesn't drive those moments in as the core part of her plot. She does it in other elements in other moments to say, okay, you need to be aware of this idea here. You know, for example, the quote you brought up there, the fact that history is written by the victors
is a debatable point, but sure, as a cliche, it's fine.
Sure. Okay. Missing history points, yeah, it affects things. And I think being willing to go in and state that, it's not her main thesis, but it is worth mentioning, and it makes her, and she's planting a flag, and that's okay. And I feel like even if you don't agree with it, you can go through it and read it and not have it diminish the piece as a whole, other than maybe the moment, you know, the moment that you had there. For me, I'm a little more applauding of that moment. Normally, I'm one who would say, you know, don't beat me over the head with things. But when your intent is to make some statements, you do need to plant a few flags.
Sure. Yeah. And I get that. And I probably honestly just was put off by it because I disagree with it. At least as a as a generalized concept. Like, yes, I understand that there are certain aspects of history that don't get taught enough. Well, guess what? None of history gets taught enough these days. Mm-hmm. Like, everybody needs to learn more about every kind of history. And that would honestly, over the long term, solve quite a lot of our problems if people knew more history of any kind. Any kind.
This has been another Legendarium tangent.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, I felt like I was kind of skirting around it, and I was like, all right, I might as well say what I mean.
Yeah.
So anyway, but there.
Can I ask though? You said, I forget exactly how you phrased it, but maybe we could go back and replay that again, Johnny. You said something about how you really like the commentary on human nature, but then when she got specific, it bothered you, or when she was trying to speak directly to a contemporary issue. But to me, I feel like this idea of like the untold parts of history or the forgotten parts of history, mm-hmm, is very human nature worthy.
Like, so what do you mean?
I mean, for her to talk about how parts of history are overlooked or not taught or, you know, intentionally erased out of, you know, whatever narratives, like that is also part of the human story and something that humans tend to do. So why is it a problem for that to be one of the things she mentions?
Well, you know, can I address that kind of Legendarium tangentially?
Sure.
The way you just said that is, you know, the way things get overlooked or erased, mm-hmm, intentionally. And I feel like that actually kind of gets at one of the heart of one of the disagreements that I have with the book. And that's that if, and this is why when I'm not reading it as some kind of allegory, I'm like, okay, no, this is, it's a great story. It's interesting. I'm really enjoying reading it stylistically. It's great to sink my teeth into, whatever. But if it is allegorical in, you know, in too strong a way, then it seems very, what's the word I'm looking for? Cynical in a kind of conspiracy theorist kind of way. It subscribes to this idea that there's a fulcrum, there's a, you know, the guardians, the whatever, there's some malevolent cabal out there that is orchestrating, or, you know, that they're keeping certain people down. And
there's a systemic problem.
No, that's actually, no, I wouldn't say that, because to say something is a systemic problem is, it's talking about the system. But what you start to get into is this kind of the conspiracy theory of there is a group of people who run the system.
Right. This right. is more, you're talking more Illuminati, not that there aren't problems with system, but
exactly.
That there's an Illuminati who is directing this whole thing.
Exactly. Okay. You can get into, here's the problem with the way things work nowadays, but I think from my understanding of the world, boy, are people going to have fun with this episode. From my understanding of the world, no, there isn't some, you know, some omni-capable group of people running things. It's no, the things are set up the way they are, and they're just running kind of naturally, running their course in some ways. And I'm going to get to something else, I think, in a minute that kind of goes a little bit against that. But no, there's no cabal. There's no guardians out there. There's no whatever that have orchestrated this system
that you know of yet, in terms of this, specifically this book series.
Once I mean, I'm not talking about the lizard people, which clearly run everything in the world, you know, discounting the lizard people. No, there's no cabal.
Yeah, my only,
but in a fantasy novel there is a cabal, like there are guardians,
and that's one of the right in this book.
Yeah,
there are guardians, and that's why I say it puts me off a little bit, and why I don't tend to agree with what I think is some of the things that she is getting at. Because if it is, you know, allegorical, even a little bit with regards to that sort of thing, then what she's saying is, no, there's these people, and if we just get to the right people, and if we just tear down, you know, whatever that cabal is,
sure,
then we'll suddenly, like, everybody will be free of that, you know, the evil taint of whatever on the world.
I feel it though, and we can get off of this in 1 second, but just this idea, like, in every fantasy series that I'm aware of via you,
sure,
there is like a cabal, or there's like one big bad guy, mm-hmm, or whatever. And the quest is to like get rid of them, strip them of their power, expose them. And if this is an allegory, I think we could say that the way the origins are treated is very similar to enslavement, right? It is enslavement. It's very similar to the American system of slavery.
Is it? It didn't feel very similar to me.
I feel like I don't know what else this would be an allegory for, personally.
Exactly. That's one of the reasons why I enjoyed the book so much, because I wasn't able to draw some easy parallel and then tear it apart.
Okay.
It was like, oh no, this is different enough that it can just kind of stand on its own.
Okay. All right. I guess the one thing I'll say is that, yeah, it does kind of sound like a conspiracy theory to be like, oh, something was intentionally erased from the record. And we've talked enough about conspiracy theories lately, just in our in our personal time.
In our kitchen.
That obviously, like, we have some shared knowledge on that. But I think one thing that makes this time in the world so tricky is that sometimes people are conspiring. Sometimes there is a conspiracy going on. That doesn't mean there's a cabal, but sometimes, like, the things that you think sound so crazy, eventually you find out that they're documented fact. And so for her to say, like, the things that were not taught in school or the things that are left out of the record, I'm like, yeah, believable. There doesn't have to be a cabal of people running that. Sometimes it's just true that, like, the system
like, I won't be has part of your system.
Anyway. That's,
and I think in this one, even with the information we have this far in the story, in drawing comparisons, specifically the Fulcrum and the Guardians, whatever, the fact is their entire system of using origins, they would have to adjust and they would have to control the narrative. Mm-hmm. And things. Otherwise,
yeah,
stills. Yeah, right. The term, mm-hmm. Stills wouldn't be willing to deal with origins, because every time they run into one, they're already terrified of them.
Mm-hmm.
They either wouldn't be willing to work with them, or you wouldn't be able to have the power structure that's there. Like it's literally, if you want to say it's an allegory, then I would say yes. There is enough there to draw the parallels of. Deals with race and everything currently.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's enough there. And I think her intention is to say that, not to say this is the way things should be and this is the way things are and this is everything's there. It's to say, look at how these people are dealing with race in this story, and take a minute and realize that it's not so far different for us now.
Mm-hmm.
Not that it is this way, but you should be able to draw enough parallels from it.
Right.
Yeah. Well, ultimately, for me, I think the thing that made me the most thematically uncomfortable wasn't all that stuff. That's all, you know, kind of small potatoes or whatever. It's interesting to talk about, but whatever. I think we get to the crux of this entire book, and I'm very interested to read books 2 and 3 to see how this particular thing plays out. And that is when Cyanite is having a discussion with, what's his name?
Alabaster.
And he says, you can't make anything better. The world is what it is. Unless you destroy it and start all over again, there's no changing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is, I think that's, in my view, a horribly misguided way to look at how human progress works. Mm-hmm. And you know how the world has worked over the last, you know, several thousand or even just the last few hundred years.
Mm-hmm.
And no, I reject the notion that we have to tear it all down just to rebuild it. And so the book, the magic system, that everything is kind of centered around this idea where, okay, so Father Earth is, you know, as long as we're getting allegorical, Father Earth is the ultimate oppressor. The thing that is keeping humankind down and is constantly threatening destruction, extinction. And so, you know, ultimately these seasons come because of a breaking and remaking. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Alabaster, and in the end, or in the beginning, I guess, depending on how we look at it, Alabaster comes to this realization, you can't fix anything, you can't improve, you have to break it and start over. And so that's exactly what he tries to do, and I just reject that notion.
And so, we'll I mean, I it's not spoiling anything. You'll deal with the aftermath and have to deal with what with his breaking.
I certainly hope so.
In the future. Yeah. And so we will definitely revisit this concept because, you know, whether Alabaster is right or not in that sentiment and the fact that he takes and is strong enough to take action to make that change, to make that happen. Mm-hmm. We'll definitely revisit it. Mm-hmm. When it comes to that statement specifically, I'm going to use another phrase that I used earlier. I agree with it a certain percentage.
Okay.
I view it the same way when there's a problem with something like a lemon car. There, you know, there have been a handful of cars in the history, and I'm not a car guy. I can't name any of them, whatever.
Ford Pinto.
There's a handful of cars that the design is just so poor that the manufacturer stops making them.
Okay.
You can still take a bad design. They've taken body pieces from those other elements. You can look through it, and at a certain point with the car, if it's not working, you can replace parts and make it work, right? But on a lemon, those parts keep breaking. So at a certain point, you have to go back and redesign. That doesn't mean you throw everything out. It means you go through and you go and say, okay, these pieces work. They're going to stay. The body style can stay. These things can do this.
Okay.
And you rebuild that way. It doesn't mean destroy everything, burn it all down, start 100%
right.
from scratch.
But
Alabaster's point is, no, you burn it all down, you
exactly.
start from scratch. And like I said, I agree with the portion of you might have to go back further than you think to change things. You might have to go back to the point where you're in blueprint saying what works, what doesn't, what makes this a lemon.
Instead of just sending it to the shop.
Instead of just
okay.
replacing
right.
a single piece.
Yeah. I think I can get on board with that. I'll think about that a little bit more, but yeah, that seems reasonable.
And I think the way I read that portion, it wasn't to me like that Jemison was making that argument, but that is a school of thought that Alabaster represents.
Yes.
There is a way of thinking about the world or even just about certain things in the world that you would say this is broken, like fundamentally, and I'm getting out of it. I'm a tarot person, and there's a card in the tarot called the Tower that really talks about that like sometimes whether it's a relationship or just like a life path that you're on, it's like this is irredeemable. There's no fixing this. There's no like adding a certain part to the car or like making this improvement on the house that's going to make it okay. It's just bad. And I think that is a school of thought, but there are other schools of thought represented in the narrative as well. And
yeah,
you know,
and that's why I say
I'm
really interested to read the second and third books, because I get the impression mm-hmm. that is the central point that she's making in this mm-hmm. book, and maybe it's not, and this is a trilogy for a reason. So mm-hmm. yeah, books 2 and 3, are we going to read books 2 and 3? People have been asking us. Yes, we're going to read books 2 and 3. Ryan's already done it. Sarah's interested.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm interested. It's happening. So we're already pretty well over an hour, but I think we have to take a few more minutes. There are a couple other things we have to address in this book. Ryan, I've got a few more things on Discord. Did you have anything else that you specifically wanted to get to, or should I ask you some Discord things?
Go ahead and toss the Discord.
Toss the Discord. All right. I don't know what that means exactly, but...
spin the Discord? I don't know.
Yeah. Wheel of Discord, turn. To throw a fox in this hen house, says okay. Jack. Do you think the book deserved the Hugo? I've got a really easy answer to this. Sarah, you...
I also have an easy answer. What's a Hugo? What's a Hugo for?
Who is Hugo,
really,
and why is he deciding all this
yeah,
stuff?
Yeah, I'm really not qualified, yeah. So I leave it to you guys.
I'm about to lose some literary credentials here.
Yeah.
My literary cred. I know of the Hugo Award. I know that it is
What's a
questionable thing. Like now there's been a whole bunch of things around it. Honestly, I remember awards and like my kids' books where it was just a silver sticker on there. Like this
yeah,
one,
yeah.
this. And it was like, cool.
The Newbery Medal.
Yeah.
Awesome.
And so, should it have won the Hugo? Sure.
Know. Yeah, sure.
I don't care if
that's
it did or didn't.
That's exactly my position. Yeah, sure. Yeah, why not? I don't know. So, I'm looking over at this shelf. We have a dedicated shelf here in the studio to the books that we have covered on the show. And if you look through this, the common theme that comes up from anywhere from, you know, David Eddings to The Chronicles of Narnia to The Odyssey, generally speaking, what we're covering is the stuff that has been around for long enough that it has floated It's, you know, the cream of the crop. It has floated to the top. Mm-hmm. And so even if it's not super old, right, you know, like we read, you know, Brent Weeks. Brent Weeks hasn't been around all that that long, but he had been around long enough at that point that enough people had recommended him that, yeah, okay, let's do him for the show. That's great. And so what we don't do on this show is cover, like, here are the top 20 books that came out in 2019. Mm-hmm. You know, whatever. Like, that's not what we do. And so because we don't keep up with the contemporary scene, we have no idea. And frankly, I don't care all that much.
If you're expecting us to be like the indie book club, you know, right. in the Portland coffee shop, it's just not us.
That's not us.
That's not us. At least not right now.
That's not to say there aren't many worthy books that you have read off of the Hugo list or whatever. Like that's fine. That's just not the way that we have decided what to read the last 6 years. So yeah. Anyway, so yeah, I don't know. Did it deserve the Hugo? As far as I'm concerned, would I give this book an award? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I thought it was really, really good. And I was especially pleased with, again, what I thought was going to be some sort of lame literary exercise that turned out to be actually really attractive to me, that second person that she pulled off really well. So, yeah, I'm into it. All right, last one from Sarah's favorite, Colonel Rabbit. Colonel Rabbit asks, when did you figure out, and here's the twist, right? Oh, okay, we're finally getting to the twist. When did you figure out all three POVs were the same character? Dun, dun, dun. How do you feel like it was executed? Or did you like how it was executed? Sarah?
I don't remember specifically when I found out, except that it's like the last available second to have found out. Like yeah. when she just said, surprise, they're the same. Like I wasn't picking up
you
on
weren't,
any
You hints. Weren't looking for that, I'm guessing.
I wasn't worried about it. And honestly, I felt a little disappointed. I'm not mad at a twist or anything, but I really liked reading this story that as I was starting it and getting familiar with each of the protagonists, I was like, this is so cool that this is a world that this author chose to portray through the eyes of three female protagonists. I was like, that's really cool, you know? And then to later find out, it's kind of like, well, yeah, she kind of had to. Like,
yeah, just
one person, but at different ages. Like, it wasn't, you know, it didn't really diminish my enjoyment at all, but it was a little bit, I just wanted them each to be important in their own right, I guess. Instead
I felt
of,
like they were.
Okay.
Yeah. I think I see what you're saying, though.
Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, I found out when it was very clearly spelled out.
Yeah, and I don't know if it's because I have more experience with fantasy or whatever. Who knows? I figured it out pretty early on. The first twist is you figure out that Cyanite is future Demaya. And then you figure out that Essun is future Cyanite. Mm-hmm. And I figured out the first twist quite early, and then the second twist a little bit closer to when the reveal happened. But mm-hmm. I did figure them both out before, and I really liked how I figured out the first one. So as I was reading through,
you're giving yourself a pat on the back.
I'm giving myself a huge pat on the back because it was so much fun. It's one of those nice little literary treasure hunts that an author can lead you on. So with the second person narrative, so that's interesting and different and whatnot. And then as I'm reading the Cyanite chapters, I realized that, oh, this is in third person present instead of the normal third person past that we usually read. And so I thought, oh, okay, well, that's interesting. And then as I was reading the Demaya chapters, you know, I'm in chapter 6, 7, whatever, I don't remember exactly where, at some point, maybe the second or third time we get her point of view, I realized that she was also in third person present. And I thought, okay, well, but if this was just some literary exercise, she would have given her a first person narrative or third person past or something different. But it's not. It's the same as Cyanite's. And so I thought, oh, okay, a little light bulb went off. And then I started looking for the little parallels that you're given early on between the two. And okay, so I figured that one out pretty quick. And because I didn't get that with the second reveal, it came a little bit later, but yeah. Ryan, do you remember back that far, book one?
Yeah, I was starting to have suspicions a bit before it's revealed. I do not have the grammatical skill set behind me to go other than to recognize first person, second person, third person type thing. So I don't catch on to the, you know, fourth person perpendicular, whatever, third person pass, whatever. I did not catch on to those hints. But there were other little things that kind of noticed. And then before it was revealed, it got spoiled for me anyway.
So really?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
I was like, oh.
I feel like that would be one of the chief joys of this book, honestly, because I thought it was really well executed.
Thankfully, I wasn't too far from the reveal anyway. It wasn't super early. But yeah, it was. I was starting to look up some other things for to try and piece together some things that just weren't making sense. And yeah, it was like, oh yeah, they're all the same. It's the same person, just at different times. And I went back and went, yep, that makes perfect sense with how everything's being written. So the real question is, from here at the end of book one, what do you think she's going to do going forward in books two and three with this? Because you've kind of closed up those first two narratives.
Yeah.
And so now you only have the one, or what are you going to do?
I don't know. I had that same thought. Where are you going to go from here? Perspective wise, is it just going to be two more books of straight Essen chapters? No, she can't do that.
Yeah.
So I don't know. She has to introduce more characters. Or she could pull a Hero of Ages. In the Hero of Ages, we suddenly turn to Spook as a main character who was very much on the periphery before. So it could be a situation where we get, what was the stupid doctor's name who I didn't care about?
Lerna?
Yeah. Maybe Lerna becomes a main character and then I, you know,
or
hang myself.
Beanoff, the one who...
Oh, Beanoff, yeah.
Tonky.
I'm like, yeah. Tonky.
Yeah, that could be interesting. Yeah, I could see that. So yeah, I have to assume something like that. It could be a character out of whole cloth or somebody we haven't met yet, but I assume a peripheral character will get a front row placement here coming soon. Okay. Oh, shut up, Siri. I don't know. What did I ever do to you? Okay, so Ryan, you're not giving me any hints with your facial characteristics here.
It wouldn't be a huge plot spoiler or anything. So,
so this is, by the way, the blue team tends to go pretty long with their Dresden episodes.
Mm-hmm.
But for us, this is one of the longest episodes we've done outside Stormlight. We're already in hour 18 and we're going to go just a little bit longer because there's one last thing that I want to bring up. And we already hinted at it a little bit before.
You want to talk about the giant rocks in the sky?
I do. Specifically one of them. No, I don't want to talk about the obelisks. That's something that will come up later.
Do the obelisks make any sense?
No, they make very little sense so far, although I do have thoughts about that, but we can talk about that next time. I want to talk about the moon and what an ineffectual final line that was.
Okay.
For me, obviously other people will feel differently, but We get okay, the last line of the story. Tell me, he says,
Alabaster speaking to Essen.
Essen, tell me, he says, have you ever heard of something called a moon? Yeah. And at this point, it's like, no, I don't care. There's no setup for this. There's no, and there's no clear reason why that would matter. You know, it's not like, it's not like he says, have you ever heard of something called a moon? And then it's a space station. Our minds are brought back to some previous passage where, you know, some celestial object interacted with this thing that brought up the power and there's no foreshadowing for this. And so for me, it was like, he says, have you heard of something called a moon? And I'm like, nope, don't care. The end. That's the end of the book. Okay, can we get on to the stuff that matters now? Like, I still want to open up book two, but I hated that final line.
Sarah, it reminded me. So I've been rewatching the show Lost.
For your sins or
just for my own enjoyment?
Oh, okay.
Actually, right. It's been great. It's been a wonderful quarantine activity. and at the end of every episode of Lost, they usually end on something that's kind of like intense or, you know, cliffhangery or something.
Which I can tell from the other room because they always have the same string hit.
Yes.
In the music.
Absolutely. And there's always, that audio like that really underscores it. And sometimes, you know, there's a lot of episodes of Lost. It was network TV back in the day when you had to have really long seasons and you had to fill them up with something. And sometimes the ends of those episodes just don't land. There was one recently where they were talking about a submarine and a plane and getting off the island. And someone said, well, how are you going to fly the plane? He's like, we're not using the plane. we're going to use the sub. And it's like, that's not interesting information. Like, you could have just said, we knew there was a sub. We knew that was one of the two options. Like, but it was just something to end on. That's how I felt about the moon. And I, also, I wanted to be like, was I supposed to know you didn't know what a moon was? Like, obviously, you don't know what a moon is, or else he wouldn't have asked that. So, do you not have a moon?
Yeah.
I didn't know that already.
So in a different book, you know, in a different author's hands, there would have been some passage where they're sneaking through the library at the Fulcrum and they come across some passage about, you know, that references the moon. What is a moon?
Have you ever heard that word before?
And I am 100% not saying that she should have had that scene. Like, you know, she has it. She, what?
Oh,
get out of here,
it.
Ryan. Whatever. Okay, we missed something.
We're poor readers.
Oh, we're bad people.
Fudge.
Anyway,
it is not spelled out as clearly as, there was a celestial object called a moon once or anything like that. But she does lay the groundwork, because I remember when I read it and went, that makes sense.
This is the part where
you were hanging on to that string.
Are you sure that's not in book two? Because
I am 100% sure, because I got it.
This is the part where Sarah and I hang our heads in shame.
I know. And what did I miss? I didn't underline anything.
Tell me at least that it's in the latter half of the book that I only read once. Okay.
No, I actually, it's probably fairly early in the, you know, I can't remember exactly. And it is a concept that is laid out a few times.
Oh my gosh. But it's in the, to me, this? It's reassuring actually that it's in the first half when you're getting so much information that doesn't make sense.
Point.
So you're like, well, I don't know. I won't pay attention to all this because I have nowhere to put it.
I wonder, because I read the first half twice in a row without the second half for context. I wonder if I went back now and read it, I'd catch
it. For sure you would. And one of the times that you read it, you were drugged as well.
That's true. I was on some pretty serious painkillers. So. Which really made the book fantastic. All right, so let's call it there. This is a pretty long episode. I hope we've given the book its due. But if there are other things that you would like us to address, then hit us up on Discord. You can find a link to that permalinked on Reddit, thelegendarium.reddit.com. You can also just shoot me a message on Twitter or whatever. I'll send you the link. So find us on Discord. We would love to see you there. There's a Jemison channel that I now get to unmute and talk to people in. I'm very excited about that.
Are they going to spoil the other books for you?
If they do, I will digitally end them.
These are your supporters. I would expect you to have a little more respect.
No, I would expect them to have respect. This is my show, not their show.
You're so fun to be married to.
So anyway, no, in seriousness, I do hope to hear from everybody. Follow us on all the social medias. If you like what we do and you want to support it, go to patreon.com/legendarium. Yes, we are doing books 2 and 3, and frankly, I'm really looking forward to it. I like this book. I think the two of you like this book, and it's going to be fun discussions going forward. Thanks for listening. See you guys later. All right, hold the phone, everybody. We're doing another episode. Not now, but Sarah, you said that you have, 8,000 more things you want to go through?
I was just saying that I showed up prepared with notes and talking points and stuff, things that I was really interested in the book, and we didn't really get to those.
Yeah.
And I'm not mad about it, but when I mentioned that, Craig was like, bonus episode.
It's just there really is a ton more to talk about.
Oh,
I think
absolutely.
And so I don't know if it probably won't be quite as long as this episode, but I hope but I feel like there is a lot more to go over. We never got to the node maintainers and there's just more to go through. Sarah's got notes. Ryan's got Ryan will be here.
I have feelings.
Yeah, Ryan has feelings. Okay, yeah, that's good.
Your
good
feelings
enough,
are
I suppose.
Welcome here.
All right, anyway, so hold standby, everybody, and we'll be back. I don't know, maybe it'll be a weekender, we can do a shorter episode, but there's more to talk about, so we'll call this part one, even though we explicitly said this wasn't part one. Yeah, I know. Okay, fine, I break my promises. I'm a bad person.